Bruce and I, we were like the closest brothers, you know, like the two of us. And I remember that, you know, when even, you know, when he came up back from school, you know, and after his social activities, you know, daily social activities, he would still come back and still, you know, play around with me. He was a very playful guy. My mother found out that that school was pretty, you know, nice, and also it was one of the most prestigious schools in Hong Kong. So after Peter, Bruce started going there, and of course Bruce only went for a few years until he finally got kicked out because of his fighting. Then I went, and then from there, like Bruce's son Brandon went there, my son went there, and who knows, maybe my son's son will go there too, you know.
He played all the games that the other little boys played, but I think his main chief interest was in Kung Fu. And after school, he grabbed his bag and off to the Kung Fu school to follow the great master. And his style of Kung Fu was Wing Chun. Yes. He likes to knock about, you know, and have a few fights and so on. And sometimes he would fight with the wrong people. I think one day he really knocked out the son of one of the tribe chiefs, and they were after him. They waited for him around the outside the school after school, and he sought refuge in, of all places, the brothers' dining room. All these serious old monks, you know, and they were standing around the table just waiting to say grace, and in dashed Bruce, you know, around the table twice and straight into the telephone room and lock himself in. The director, Brother Patrick, who was an Irishman, Patrick Turner, said to me, "Go over there, Henry, go over there and see what that silly old fool is doing there." So I said, I went there, opened it. I hadn't realized that down below, you know, that he had to run the gauntlet. To Bruce, get out. But I was told that when he got down, he really had to run the gauntlet. But he was well able to take care of himself. I mean, he's a wonderful fellow. Very brave, you know, not afraid.
Now, you get out of here. I'm warning you. You bastards can't push us around. You want to fight? I'll take you on.
He came over to the United States in 1959, not because he wanted to, because he was forced to, in a way, because at that point, his fighting got so bad that there were, like, you know, the people from the police department at the college, you know, summoning my mother over there, and, you know, sort of warning my mother, saying that, you know, should there be any more fighting from Bruce, you know, any more reports about his fighting, that he'll be arrested. So my mom, you know, of course, you know, talked to my dad, and my dad decided that it would be best for him to change environment, change friends. So, and they have friends, like my father had a friend from the opera, you know, in Seattle, and they contacted and they made an arrangement whereby Bruce could stay there and go to school there. And since Bruce was born here in the United States, that it would be natural, you know, for him to stay there and, you know, and see if he'll change. And change he did.
I first met Bruce Lee about 1959. I had been into judo for a short time, and having worked out with a bunch of young kids, I was getting hurt all the time, and so I thought I better hang this up. And one of the fellas that knew Bruce prior to me came by and said he'd met this young Chinese lad that were just a whiz, and so he arranged for us to meet. And during those times, we were working out in the ballparks and city parks and wherever we could get a space to work out. And so when I went to meet the group, I had some premonitions. I'd seen some karate and judo and different things like that, and I felt like, well, what's this 19 or 18 year old kid gonna show me? But when we got together and he was asked to, you know, to demonstrate something to me, why, it was just incredible. And I thought, my God, this is really something. So that's how I got involved with him. I met Bruce, and he was one of the fellows that taught me that that, you know, that we are equal. You know, I'm no better than you, but I'm no less equal than you are. And through the martial arts, it just further helped me to develop myself, to bring myself back from the gutter that I was in. And so I have to really feel honored that I was one of the few people that was able to have met Bruce, and that kind of resurrected my own life structure. Short time after Bruce and our gang got together working out, we decided to start a little school here. And so this is the first school that we started. At that time, from this pillar to that pillar was one room with an upstairs, and we practiced both downstairs and upstairs. At 18, but he had such a deep endowment of the philosophy of the Orient, Zen and Taoism, that he could be telling you the raunchiest jokes in 1 minute, and then he could focus on something very serious and give you something in a wonderful philosophy that made you want to just stick around and learn it all.
Bruce was an individual that you know, he looked at everything. He didn't have this tunnel vision like I'd seen in Oriental martial arts before. He tried everything and anything. If it worked, he kept it. If it didn't work, he threw it out. So I became part of the group, and here I am, 30 odd years later. I'm still Taki, and I still teach here in Seattle. And we're still teaching in what is basically the old Bruce Lee school. He gave me a new challenge. You know, he gave me a challenge that I'm going to set a path for you, and I, you know, for Taki and myself, and I want you to, you know, I want you to put your first foot on this pathway, and I'm still stumbling down that pathway, somewhat. But I think I've achieved more in the last, say, 20 odd years by knowing him, you know, knowing the system. It's given me a chance to reach deeper inside myself. And though I'm not what you would classify a young man anymore, I'm still finding more within myself every day.
My experience with Bruce is different than Taki's and Roy's, because I was younger than Bruce. So Bruce looked on me as like a younger brother, whereas he was actually drawing knowledge from Taki and Roy and from my uncle, Fred, who was a judo sensei. And it was interesting, but again, Bruce, when you came in contact with him, he would influence your life. And that's my uncle, being in the martial arts, I remember around the table, he said, "Boy, I've met this Chinese little kid, punk kid, and he's just something special." And he knew it then. And it was just a few weeks later that I was able to meet Bruce. And I was influenced by him. I could see the that special package that he had, that he brought. Bruce's sense of humor was always there. And one time he went up to the center post that went all straight from the basement all the way to the second floor. He went up to this and he says, "Fred, watch this." And then he started just going like this to this post. And it started shaking the house. And he just kept doing it a little bit more and more. And it got to the point where my aunt ran in from the kitchen and said, "There's an earthquake, there's an earthquake." Because Bruce was shaking the house so much that the floor was going like this. The furniture was actually kind of jumping off of the floor. And that the plates and the glasses were just, you know, falling out of the cupboards. And my aunt came out yelling, "Earthquake, earthquake," and she looked at, you know, my uncle, and my uncle just had this quizzical look on his face, said, "Oh, it's not my fault, it's," you know, he pointed to Bruce, and then Bruce just had that impish grin on his face and just shrugged his shoulders. But then there was Bruce's sense of humor right there.
Well, he was here about 5 years in 64, but prior to 64, he had met Ed Parker, who was a Kempo karate man. He was probably one of the guys that really started the martial art, you know, concept in the United States. And Ed was having these international tournaments in Long Beach every year. And so when he met Bruce, and I can't remember just exactly how they met, but sometime when he had gone down there, he had met Ed Parker. And of course, Ed was very impressed with his abilities and the things that he could do. And so he would invite Bruce down as a guest demonstration in all the tournaments. And of course, Bruce always took me with him. You know, I was his leading dummy, and he needed me like a hole in the head, but he told Ed that he had to have me go down with him. And so I got a free passage down there each year. And during these times why he was exposed to some of the honored guests like Blake Edwards and some of these movie star people, and that's how he became in contact with some of the movies that they were making, TV series that they were making, like Batman, and of course they came up with the Green Hornet, and they wanted him to come down and be interviewed for that, and so that's how he got started in the movie industry down there.
I don't think I met Bruce. I was trying to think back on it. I don't think I met Bruce until the press party. Adam introduced us both, and we were there, and that's the first time I'd met Bruce, and we really didn't have much time to sit down and talk or anything else, but I liked him from the moment I met him. He was really a very personable guy. I found out later on that his prime ambition was to exploit the Jeet Kune Do, and he wasn't particularly all that interested in the acting and had not really studied it that much, though he was sufficient. His biggest problem was he had a very thick Chinese accent that was very hard to understand. And a lot of the lines that he read, people just couldn't understand them. So they slowly but surely took a lot of his lines away to where it was mostly he just did action stuff and whatever.
The Green Hornet was, I think, more fun because the cast and the crew got along so well. It was a great camaraderie, and it was a wonderful show to work on.
He didn't understand how to film Kung Fu, and we just kind of let him run with it, and Benny and he got in some arguments about how to do it and this, that, and the other. Bruce always liked to work in real close, and he would occasionally hurt somebody. And so we went through a lot of stuntmen, a lot of them that didn't want to work on the show, you know. He couldn't understand that you could draw way back, and as long as somebody was doing, you know, throwing their head right or doing their back flips or whatever, that you didn't have to work in that close. And the whole show was done in what's called low-key lighting, which it was very dark and very mysterious and everything else. Well, he was in black. And he would come into a scene and do all of this stuff, and he was just a blur, and these bodies were flipping all over everywhere to the point of where it got comical. And Bruce did not want to show, you know, Jude Kune Do as comical at all. So we just let him run with it, and then we took him in one day to see the, you know, and we didn't let anybody know. We snuck in the back, we didn't let him, and of course there was a lot of people watching the dailies, you know. And they'd laugh. Well, Bruce was very upset about that, so he finally went to Benny and said, okay, I give up. I don't know what I'm doing. Tell me what to do. So we slowed him down. We backed him off. We did certain lighting things of where it showed his kicks and what we were doing, because most of the stuff we were just missing with the camera. He was so fast. And I never will forget one scene that they had of where he had to... I forget what it was. A guy came out of a closet or something and had a gun. And Bruce came in and he did a kick, spun in midair, and kicked the guy's hand. He was supposed to kick the whole hand and the gun was supposed to go. He kicked and he kicked the guy's hand and the gun went, the hand went away and the gun just hung there. He spun all the way around and kicked the guy in the stomach and he caught the gun in midair and hit the guy with the gun in between his foot, and it really hurt the guy, you know. But the speed was just unbelievable.
He was constantly training, yes. He was very, very diligent in that he was always working out and training and always in motion. Like Van said, he never sat down.
I think he was great. He had a lot of enthusiasm. He kind of ran people around the set nuts because he was always doing his kicks and this, that, and the other. And I remember a number of times I was standing there watching the thing, you know, like this, and I'd feel a... He had jumped up in the air and reached out with his toe and ticked you on the ear, you know. Well, that stopped when one of the grips was standing there, and just as he did it, he turned to the right, and the guy hit him in the jaw and dislocated his jaw. But he was always so full of enthusiasm for his martial arts, you know. He was teaching even when he's doing this. He had his own little school down in Chinatown somewhere.
We worked out every weekend and every Wednesday. Sometimes, most of the times, Ted would be there too. Almost for 2 weeks, for almost 6 years, all the time. I helped him move from, when I first met him, he was in Culver City behind the MGM studios there, and I helped him move to Bel Air and examine the house for me, sure it was a sound investment, a sound house structurally, because I'm pretty good mechanically. And Bruce was a person who wasn't very good. He wasn't, in spite of his artistic abilities and his finer points, mechanically, he was a klutz. Well, that's where I came in. Mechanically, I have a high degree of mechanical ability. I can build anything or make anything, and Bruce couldn't. You couldn't touch him as far as a martial artist is concerned, or an artist, or an actor, too, see? Bruce was practicing slipping punches. He liked to keep sharp all the time. Even though he's been a martial artist and he's top in his field, he still has to keep sharp, so, yeah. So he was just practicing slipping punches. I'd give him left jabs and he'd slip them a little bit and dodge. Well, this time he overreacted. For some reason, I don't know, and he overreacted. His head went way down, and my instinct is automatically an uppercut, like this, and I caught him in the mouth, and he cut his lip open, and he is bleeding. And for a minute, now ordinarily I'm not scared, see, not hardly anything really scares me. Hardly anything really scares me. For a minute there, my head was about 8 inches away from his. He's looked up at me, and for a minute, he has brown eyes. For a minute, his eyes turned green. I could see, I got scared for a fraction of a second. I can see the reaction, because I knew Bruce had this violent temper. I knew he could just tear me apart. As a matter of fact, in 1/10 of a second, I'd be a pile of bones on the ground.
With his explosive power and speed, I was in awe. Everybody was, his hand sensitivity, trapping. I've never seen things like that before. His grappling, his punching, his kicking were never seen before, a witness. And I told my buddies, you know, we ought to work with a guy like this. Truth in the martial arts. And he says that, yeah, he's going to have a class coming up. In about 6 months, he found out we're going to have a class coming up, but we got to write to him. I wrote to him. Out of six of us who wrote to Bruce, I was accepted, and I was fortunate to belong to that first Chinatown formal class that Bruce had in I think the late 64 or six, no, 66 or 67. It was called then the Zhongfan Kung Fu Institute. People don't know that Lee Zhongfan was Bruce Lee's birth name, and that's what he named his school after, Lee Zhongfan Kung Fu Institute.
He was great. He was different because at that time, there was nobody heard of karate per se, with the flying kicks and the chops and the tickles and tackles. And this man did it, and he liked me because I had a rough idea of how he worked, and I took falls for him. And a lot of the stuntmen didn't understand because his style was moving very rapidly. He'd hit you in 10 different spots, and as a stuntman, you wouldn't know to grab your jaw and say, that hurt, or your stomach, you know? So the stunt coordinator did his best to slow Bruce Lee down, because the Western way they accepted is the old John Wayne method, where you'd reach from left field, tell a story, and hit the man. Bruce, he'd like to throw 37 kicks and 12 punches. And it was just a different way, and a lot of people say, well, that's no good, but it got over, and people wanted to see more and more of Bruce Lee.
He was very shy then, very sweet, very retiring, and the kind, and then he would explode with this energy, and the juxtaposition of it was really startling. And then he was always talking about health. That's what I remember. And I seem to think, I remember something about taking ox blood, and I don't know whether that's something I read someplace or something, but he was taking mega vitamins then before anybody did, and he was extremely involved in fitness. And of course it showed. And of course we would all stand around the set and just watch what he was doing.
He wasn't the type that would joke per se. You could make him laugh, but he wouldn't laugh in front of a bunch of people. He didn't strike me. Everything was very business-minded. He wanted to be the top. And if you want to be the best in anything, you have to be a fanatic. And he was the ultimate fanatic. He was great at what he did.
He would watch very intently what was going on. It wasn't just he did his part and went off in a little corner like a lot of actors do. They go and prepare for their role, but he would stand around very quietly and watch what else was going on, and that probably helped him in his future film work.
And this is a true story. I walked into my office to meet Bruce, who presumably was going to be there, and he grabbed me. He was hiding behind the door, and he grabbed me from behind and held me from behind, and for a moment or two, I didn't know what or who it was. I was totally stunned, and he wouldn't let me go, and I couldn't get away from him, and so our introduction tended to favor him somewhat more than me, but I had control of the scripts after that, which he became aware of.
I remember him as being very intense, and very pulled taut, you know, like a steel wire that was almost ready to break, you know, if it could be broken, because he was really wound up. I always felt that he was ready to charge at something. They had a punching bag on the set all the time, a big heavy bag, you know. During the day he would go to it and work on it. And one time he did one of his kicks and broke the chain. That was, caused a little eyebrow raising, you know.
He had a very unique skill and a very unique personality. And I say again, I think part of his success was that he was very accessible as a person. He had a charm that all of the people who have tried to copy him, none of them have had. That genuine charm and warmth and kind of facility with people that he had.
He was kind of a solitary figure who was sort of there and waiting. And, you know, I'd say, hi, Bruce. He's, oh, hi. You know, we'd shake hands and sort of, I put my arm around him and we'd talk a little bit, sort of small talking. But he was always waiting to be ready to do what he had to do. Nice. I felt a nice feeling about him.
He was always saying he was waiting until he got a little older before he philosophized or whatever, but... He would tell you stories sometimes, especially like the dragon, and then just leave you with no explanation, and you, for a couple of months you'd have to worry about what the hell was he really talking about, you know. The one I'll never forget, he says, here's this old woodcutter, Chinese woodcutter, of course, yeah? All Chinese. And he says he's chopping wood, and the bushes and the trees start shaking, and a dragon walks right out, right between the trees, and it's a real dragon. He says there's smoke coming out of his nostrils, and this Chinaman says, gee whiz, that's a real one. If I could capture it, or if I could kill it, I'd be famous, I'd be wealthy. You know? So he takes his axe, and he takes a step toward the dragon, and the dragon says, ho, 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 you son of a gun. I can read your mind, and I know what you're thinking. And if you take one more step, I'm going to blow fire all over you and burn you to a cinder. And the Chinaman thinks, well, he knows what I'm thinking before I... How could I even possibly catch it or anything? It's useless. So he goes back to chopping wood, and he's chopping, and he's chopping, and he's chopping. He says, right in the middle of one of them chops, he says, the axe flew out of his hand and hit the dragon right between the eyes. Yeah, and then what? That's the end of the story. And for a couple of months, I keep thinking about this thing. What the heck's going on? He says, if you have to think about it, it's too late. It has to be without thought. Practice it so well that it's automatic and that it happens without thinking about it. And that's the way he thought it would be, you know, effective, and then you're a martial artist, right?
In the same period, you know, as I was training with Bruce, I noticed that he had several, you know, very famous students like James Colburn, Steve McQueen, and most of all, of course, that big gentleman, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. You know, when I say big, he's tall, 7'2". And I still remember, like, you know, he would come to our house and he would have to like bend down just to get across that, you know, the door. But he was a very nice gentleman. But James was a very eloquent gentleman, you know, very good with words and so forth. And I always liked his voice, you know, very strong, boomy voice, you know. And so anyway, and Steve was a different type of gentleman. He some speaks, but he was very down to earth, you know, straightforward type guy, nice guy. So yeah, Bruce never really let those things get to his head. You know, he was always level, you know. He would never like be cocky or anything like that. Because to him, they're all friends. They're all, you know, people.
It was all just filled with energy, just boom, you know, just bursting with energy. And so we talked for a little bit, and he said, what have you been doing? And then I said, well, all I've done is that thing. He said, yeah, but you did a lot of flicky stuff. Flicky. Pine, nothing really. So I said, oh, really? And then he said, I've got a one-inch punch that is better than anything you did. And I said, really? I'd like to see that. And he said, get a pillow. And so I stood up, put a pillow in front of me, and hold it, and bang, like that. Knocked me into the chair. The chair fell down. I rolled over into the corner with a one-inch punch. I got up, and I said, let's go to work, man. That looks like fun.
He could tell, you know, he had abilities that a lot of people don't know about. He told me, he says, I can watch somebody walk around for about 5 minutes. I can just about tell you how he can fight. So he knew what your physical capabilities were, you know. And he had things that were, we didn't have him around long enough to learn about all this. He is almost like he had a sixth sense, you know.
He was single-minded. His total focus was on martial arts and his evolution of it. He wanted to be a movie star, and he wanted to use this in order to exemplify his art, and, you know, to make money and do the things that he wanted. He wanted to make more money than Steve McQueen per film, and did for one film anyway. He probably would have achieved more if he'd lived longer, but that was an aim that he accomplished. He accomplished most of his aims, I believe.
It was very difficult for Bruce to, you know, to have to go back to Hong Kong, per se, to really make it. Because, you know, he figured that, you know, he's been here such a long time, and he's done the Green Hornet series, and it had good ratings, and, you know, but since then, you know, like, he struggled so hard to get a main role, but he never got one. So it got to a point where, you know, his friend James Coburn, talked to him and said, well, Bruce, he said, if I were you, I will go back to your place of origin, which is Hong Kong. And he said, since martial arts is a universal language, you know, if you make it big there, he said, I'm sure, you know, everywhere else in this world, people will want you, you know. And that's what he did, and he made it.
He came back to Hong Kong, and of course, he brought his son and his whole family, as a matter of fact. But he brought his son to LaSalle. He came to see me straight from the airport. He came up to my office huffing and taking in tow his two children, Brandon and Sharon, and the wife trying to keep up with him. He greeted me and said he was so happy to see me again after so many years, and paid me a compliment for staying, looking still so young.
Well, in the early days, he was appearing in Green Hornet over the television in Hong Kong. We are very proud to have a Chinese, you know, who feature overseas in American productions, and it's very good, and we know he's very good martial art. So the first thing we did was to get him on Enjoy Yourself, which I was producing, and he was an instant success. He did contribute a lot, because I believe even Raymond Chow, you know, saw him on television, and I believe was through the exposure on television and his demonstration and so on, brought perhaps to his attention.
Curious thing is, of course, that to read what Bruce wrote about the martial arts, about Jeet Kune Do and so forth, is very kind of soft, a minimalist approach to martial arts. And then you see him on the screen, and suddenly it's pow, you know, my God, what's happening here? It's a totally different thing. But Bruce realized very well that there's a big difference between martial arts as a martial art, as a study, if you like, and how to express that on the screen. A, he knew what to do, and B, he had the ability to do it. And even though what he did on the screen was so much bigger and everything more exaggerated than he would ever do or ever teach himself, it still had such authenticity behind it. Because, I mean, even if the expression was showy, the substance was real, because he had that training. And he had this amazing persona, this character just came roaring out through the screen.
Bruce Lee was working on Sanjing Mong Moon.
Fist of Fury.
And there's not enough stuntmen. And also in that time, I kind of like the best stuntman in Hong Kong. They need a stunt guy to double the Japanese, go through the window. Then they call up, Jackie, can you do that? And because I think the high, the body, I looks like a Japanese guy. So I said, okay, I do it. After I do the stunt, the Bruce Lee come, they're quite difficult, the stunt. Then Bruce Lee come to hug me. Oh, what's your name? I said, my name is Jackie. Oh, you good, you great. When Bruce Lee kick, you don't shake your eyes, because when you shake your eyes, you cannot see Bruce Lee kick. No, how fast? No, because the roommate, the mix, Bruce Lee, a lot of pressure. You know, human being, just human being, cannot, like a cartoon. No, how fast? That's the fastest you can be. Even Muhammad Ali, you know, right now Tyson, the punch, fast, but you still can see.
I think you'd probably agree, Bruce, that yes. The thing that's limited the appeal of Chinese films to Western audiences is that it's very unusual to find a Chinese actor who can act. And when I say that, I mean act in the Western style.
Yes, it definitely has, you know, because when I first arrived, you know, I did the Green Hornet, you know, television series back in 65. And as I look around, man, I mean, I saw a lot of human beings. And as I look at myself, I was the only robot there, because I was not being myself, and I'm trying to accumulate external security, external technique, the way to move my arm, the way, but never to ask and say what Bruce Lee would have done.
Well, I was a friend of Raymond Chow, the producer of Golden Harvest, and I heard that he was looking for me to be in one of his films. So I happened to be walking by his office one day and decided to just go in and see what it was. And he said, can you shoot tomorrow? We've got one with Bruce Lee. And I actually wasn't familiar with Bruce Lee at the time. And but I said, why not? I haven't done that before. So he said, we'll pick you up at 8 o'clock in the morning. And we started shooting that next morning. He said he wanted me to be the big boss. Yeah, Bruce was terrific to work with. He really was. I mean, I had not been in any films before, but he made everybody feel at ease, and There was never any pressure. He made it fun. So there were very few double, triple takes. I mean, it was, you take one and okay, wrap it, take another one, you know, and do another scene. So, but he was good at making sure that everybody knew what they were doing before they took the cameras rolled. And so but he was good. If there was somebody make a mistake, he didn't get upset, he made a joke about it. And so it was never any pressure at all.
The guy was really quite a super guy, not on a big mega ego trip, you know. On the set, he was so friendly to all of us. As you can see from some of the pictures, the still pictures from that film, you know, he was always mixing around with us. Whenever there was no filming, he was always talking to us and making jokes and telling us about his life in America and basically very friendly and would never refuse to take shots with any one of us, because of course we were all proud to be with Bruce Lee on the set. You know, we'd always ask him, you know, you mind we take a picture with you? You know, it's anytime, you know, anytime. And of course that's how we got some of the pictures that we have.
I remember clearly turning up on the set of The Way of the Dragon thinking to myself, this is going to take, you know, half a morning. It's just a little fight scene. And I've never been so wrong. Bruce Lee was a perfectionist and he had every move planned down to the last quarter inch. And he would try it this way and then that way, and he'd have me doing one bit and then he says, no, that's not quite right. Let's get Mark Mitikingi over here, you do it. And then when he was finally satisfied, we had rehearsal after rehearsal. And he did warn us, you know, if you make a wrong move, if you've moved, you know, half an inch too far in this direction, you may actually get hit by the nunchaku sticks. Unfortunately, I did, and I've got a small scar to show for it. I didn't feel the pain at the time. The pain came when he shook my hand to say he was sorry, because he had very strong hands, and he'd shake my hand and says, I'm really sorry. And my hand was, you know, I thought my bones were breaking, because he's very strong.
He's very, very lovely person, very happy to. Especially if you are working on the units, the people really like each other. They love him, you know. But he does sometimes very upset when he has a bad mood on the shooting. That's his between the acting part and his own profession requirements.
Bruce is very intense, and he could be very, you know, I guess unpleasant would be a word to the lazy, because he was funny, but he knew where his sense of humor, you know, was where it should be. But he was very intense about what he was doing. And on the set of Way of the Dragon, Return of the Dragon, he was doing too much, in my opinion. I mean, he was the director, the stunt coordinator, the star, the writer. I mean, he was everything. And we're in Rome, which was very unique for a Chinese film. At that time, it was an incredibly high budget at that time, $250,000. That was just unheard of in the Chinese film community. And there was no script. I mean, he was writing as he went along. And so he was very put upon. He was pressed and he was stressed, and he wanted everybody doing everything. And I guess really the reason Chuck and I got along with him so well is that we're professionals. I mean, we were up early, we were ready to go. We would do anything. We would carry the bag, you know, rub the back, move the camera. But I remember one time, you know, coming from a farm background and a hard work ethic, sitting there when I wasn't in a scene. And Chuck and Bruce were doing something, and after the scene was over, Bruce came over and he said, what are you doing in the chair? I don't have anything to do. He said, BS, you should be behind the camera all the time. He said, if you're not in front of the camera, you should be behind the camera. And so he was quick to let you know that he expected everybody to be looking at every hit and seeing it was a collective effort. Then after he taught me how to take hits, then he expected me to teach everybody else how to take hits, anybody that didn't know that came on the set. So he was a pro, and he was really, he taught me a lot about the film business. He was a very talented guy. He had a lot of experience. He started acting when he was just a kid, 5 or 6 years old. And so he really knew his craft. He understood cameras, he understood angles. Not only was he a brilliant martial artist, there's a lot of martial artists maybe have similar talents in certain ways, but they're hypothetically a 2-inch nozzle and they get a 1/4-inch nozzle on screen. Bruce was a 6-inch nozzle, got 6 inches on screen. He really knew how to show his craft off. But it was hard work. It was something that he studied very diligently, and so he earned it like anything else.
I mean, it was the first days of shooting were really
amazing because, you know, Bruce wouldn't come out. I mean, Bruce did everything to avoid starting. He just, he had, this went wrong, or he was stiff, or he wanted to do some thinking. And I mean, and we finally started shooting without him. And we just shot road shots, and just because we had a unit there, we were ready to go. And he finally came in. The very first scene we shot is the scene where he's in his room, and Anna Capri parades in all these girls for him to pick a girl. Because we figured it took the easiest scene, he didn't have to move. And he was physically, he was a wreck. I mean, he was, if you look at the scene carefully, I mean, you can see his mouth is trembling. I mean, he was just so anxious and nervous. Not that he wasn't good, but it was important for him. This was his first starring English language. I mean, this is, you know, everything that he was hoping for it to be. And we got through it, and then once we got started, he was wonderful. I mean, he was in there, and whenever there was a problem, and there were lots of communication problems with the Chinese, and the whole working ethic there is very, if you've been there, then you know about, this is somebody's rice bowl, so you don't touch it. I mean, it was so hot when we were filming the mirror scene, and I wanted to have fans up on top of the set to blow out the hot air. And nobody would put them up because nobody knew whose job it was because it had never been done before. And the electricians wouldn't do it because everybody's afraid that they're going to take work away from somebody else. I mean, you have these giant crews, but everybody gets very little money. But it's a living for everybody, and nobody wants to do anything that would hurt somebody else's potential living. So whenever we run into things like this, which happened often, you know, we'd get Bruce, and Bruce went in there, and they would die for him. I mean, he was just so revered.
Fighting techniques are carefully choreographed by Bruce Lee and the director. Discipline and coordination are the only protection against possible lethal accident. Under this drive for perfection, Lee and the other actors put in over 12 hours of work to recreate a single kung fu sequence. Actresses from Hong Kong add a touch of the exotic to the film in the form of an ancient Chinese art. The tattooing will support the colorful mood of a scene that they'll shoot in a tea house. First, Bruce Lee runs through the grips and reflexes the girls will need to execute kung fu. Then they'll be ready to handle customer John Saxon. For an illusion within an illusion, 8,000 mirrors are brought in to form a set. The cinematographer plans to film the violent but ballet-like action of Bruce Lee and Shun King in slow motion to give the scene a new dimension in action pictures. The director must confine the movement between the actor and the mirrors to hide all possible reflections of cameras and lights. It will take hours of coordination and planning before Robert Klaus and Bruce Lee are set. Arts Academy forms the background for a dangerous and complicated fighting sequence. 200 students and masters will participate in an all-out battle. The company strives for the ultimate in authenticity. Exacting precision must be maintained, for one mistake of an inch or less will provide a disabling injury. Fatigue, produced by rehearsal after rehearsal, became the greatest danger. In Hong Kong, the greatest kung fu fighters in the world are keeping alert under the intense physical strain. There is no other way to make a motion picture called Enter the Dragon.
For me, it's just a sort of wonderful vulnerability. And as we got towards the end of the film, the excitement, I mean, you know, we knew that we had something. And I knew Bruce was thrilled with it. And when we had it all together and Bruce came over and, he just... the joy of seeing this guy having realized a life, you know, his life's dream. And, I felt very good about that, very sort of excited to be part of that.
Come on!
as a shock. I remember that day, my mother and I, we went out shopping for a turntable that I wanted, and I was holding on to that box there, and while my mother was opening the main door, and when we walked in, the phone rang, and my mother picked up the phone while I was trying to open the box, set the thing up. All of a sudden, I heard, she was behind me, and I heard, you know, her crying real hard. I turned around, I thought something, she hurt herself or something, but I asked her, what happened? She said, Bruce died. I said, no, can't be.
When I heard that he had died, passed away, I was saddened, and I'm sure everyone else was, because he was so young, and he was so good.
I don't believe it. I was over on the street, I ran Jim Sajay, then some people, hey, Jackie, Bruce Lee died. I said, no. You're kidding. No, it's serious.
It just left me in total shock because it was a man that was, in my eyes, just totally invincible. I mean, he was 5'7", 130 pounds, but he was probably one of the most dynamic people you could ever meet. And in my eyes, he was a guy where nobody could touch him.
Got bombarded with mail and calls about Bruce, and they want to continue and learn his method of martial arts. And Dan and I agreed, let's open up the Kali Academy. We named it the Kali Academy, so that we can share and continue Bruce's teaching.
He completed his life, I think. I don't know what more he could have done. I mean, his influence is still felt, is still being felt. His technique is sure, it's down on film and it's in his books. And it's in the memory of most of us. I mean, that's why we're here today, still trying to find out what it was that made him so great.
Ah! My dad started training me as soon as I could walk. He trained me while he was alive, and after he passed away, I just kind of kept at it because I didn't really think about it much. You know, you know how you get started at something, you just continue with it. And my dad had a circle of students that were close to him, and so they were friends of our family. My dad left a really wonderful legacy, and I meet people all over the world who really admire him and admire his work, and really have been very positively affected by it too, you know. And I wouldn't want to do anything to mar that.
Since Bruce died in 1973, there's been so much, you know, written about him, and not only written, but in all media, you know. And some of it is good, and some of it is like lies and everything, and, you know. So it's got to a point where our family, the Lee family, we've decided to come out with a story on Bruce, a complete story. So all the records should be set straight.
He was just a gentle soul.
An incredible motion that you see before your eyes.
You know, not only do you lose a friend, but you lose an influence.
It made such a big impression on my life.
It was just a joy to watch him.
Nobody can touch him.
This character just came roaring out through the screen.
Crazy Galoot.
A final setting to a very beautiful story. A young man who bloomed forth and then faded.